Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our closing session. Dr. Jennifer Miller will present a year in review for PWS. As many of you know, Dr. Miller is a professor of pediatric endocrinology at the University of Florida. Her research focuses on treatment of individuals with Prader-Willi syndrome and early onset obesity. The majority of her research efforts currently are focused on identifying the etiology and possible treatment of hyperphagia and metabolic abnormalities in Prader-Willi syndrome. She's been working with individuals with Prader-Willi syndrome and early onset obesity for the past 18 years. She currently follows over 400 patients with Prader-Willi syndrome from around the world. Dr. Miller, welcome.
Thank you so much, Paige. Whoops, hold on. There we go. Am I on? No, there. Jeez Louise, technical difficulties.
Yes, so we see you now.
Now you see me, aren't you so excited? All right. All right, can you see my slides? Yes?
Yes, you are good.
I am good, all right. So I am gonna present a year or two in review since the last time we had a conference. And so some of this, I apologize if you were at the scientific day on Thursday, because some of it's gonna be repeat. And so I'm sorry about that. And if you weren't and you were on Dr. Agarwal's talk this morning, it's also gonna be a little repeat, but not everything. So hang in there. And at the end, I've got a cute slideshow to show you. So, all right, so the presentation today, we're gonna review current diet recommendations and what's changed over the years, as well as talk about supplements, review endocrine and other medical issues, and then review clinical trial data very briefly, because there was, as you know, a pharmaceutical session earlier today where most of that data was reviewed already. So this is a slide taken from an article by Matej Tolbert and Charlotte Hoiby that was in The Lancet earlier this year. And I just like it because it shows the nutritional phases that Dan Driscoll and I described back in 2011 in a much more beautiful way than our table does. And so you can see that the nutritional phases, individuals progress from phase 1A when they're babies and have anorexia and basically don't want to eat and have to be force-fed. To 1B when they have a normal appetite. 2A is when weight gain becomes easier without a change in calories or diet. And then 2B is an increased interest and awareness of food. This is when there starts to be a lot of food-related questions, a lot of anxiety. Skin picking often will start in phase 2B because of the anxiety. There's a lot of comparison of portion sizes and why does he get this and I don't get this. And then that leads into the sort of classic phase of Prader-Willi that we all worry about and think about, which is nutritional phase 3, where there's hyperphagia. So the reason we do the diet the way we do it is at the University of Florida is based on the premise that sweet taste alters a bunch of stuff in the body in not a good way. So, and this is true for anyone, okay? This is not just Prader-Willi, it's just that Prader-Willi has a more exaggerated response, okay? So when you expose a child to sweet taste chronically, now we're talking chronic, we're not talking like here or there every once in a while, but chronically expose a child to sweet taste. So for example, we see this all the time. The kid doesn't like plain water because most kids with Prader-Willi don't like plain water. So the mom puts a splash of juice, just a splash, or some Mio drops, or uses the Honest Kids one because it's less sugar. Those things are all sweet taste. And the more you use them, the more you expose the child to them, this is when this happens. And it happens in three ways. First, in the gut. The sweet taste, the taste hitting the taste receptors, the sweet taste receptors on the tongue will alter the gut microbiome. And it alters it in a way that it allows overgrowth of certain bacterial species in the gut that promote insulin resistance and also promote increased calorie absorption. Okay. The second way is in the pancreas, where it promotes hyperinsulin response. So an exaggerated insulin response in response to the sweet taste. And third is in the brain, where it sort of downregulates your pleasure response to the sweet taste over time. So like an addiction, you need more and more and more to get the same pleasure out of it. So you crave it, you want it. And what you can see at the bottom in this little cartoon is that this is typical for anyone who suffers from obesity, okay? And so it doesn't have to be Prader-Willi, it's anybody that this hyperinsulinism then leads to increased fat weight, which then leads to worse insulin resistance, and it's a cycle. And then you develop all the consequences of obesity, like high blood pressure, high cholesterol, you know, that kind of stuff. So this is an example of why we do this. And we learned this way back many years ago when Dan Driscoll and I did the natural history study of Prader-Willi syndrome. And here you see in the left on the orange are lean individuals with Prader-Willi and nutritional phases 2A and 2B. So weight under excellent control, normal weight for their height. And then on the blue is the siblings. And then in the pink is people with other causes of obesity and prediabetes. And what you can see in this graph is that post-meal, individuals with Prader-Willi syndrome mount insulin responses that are just about equal to those who have early onset obesity from other causes and prediabetes. So even though these individuals are very normal weight, they're not overweight in any way, shape, or form, they still have this hyperinsulin response that happens. And the problem with that insulin response is that that hyperinsulin response will, as I said, it drives up fat weight, it drives up appetite, it can cause problems with puberty that are very common in Prader-Willi syndrome. It causes decreased cognitive function and it causes mood disorders. So our thought is that if we can control this insulin response in some way with the diet, that hopefully we can ameliorate some of this stuff that happens in the syndrome. So as you are probably all aware, the current diet recommendations have always been, or at least for as long as I've been around, 5 to 7 calories per centimeter of height per day in order to maintain body weight once an individual is done growing, or even while they're growing. But the problem with that is, as we all know, it's very difficult to sustain that low of calories. Number one, just because it is. And number two, because you're taking hungry kids and you're calorie restricting them. And that makes it worse. You know, that makes them more hungry. And the other reason why is because low calorie diets typically contain non-nutritive sweeteners. So, you know, it's a trade-off, right? You low calorie means low fat usually and more simple carbs. So things, you know, like diet Jell-O or diet Coke or whatever that contain non-nutritive sweeteners. And the problem with those non-nutritive sweeteners is that they are associated with weight gain. And the thing is we as human beings, we all have an innate craving for sweetness. It's just built into us, even in the absence of hunger. So when we used to do functional MRI studies, you know, you could put an individual into the scanner and look at their brain activity. You'd feed them a meal, you know, big meal, they'd be full, show them pictures of Big Macs and French fries and whatever, no response. Show them a picture of chocolate, boom, brain lights up. We have an innate craving for sweetness. And even the smell of chocolate, we would waft chocolate in by a like oxygen thing and their brain would light up like crazy. So it's built in and it's worse in Prader-Willi. So it's actually compounded in Prader-Willi, that sort of response to sweetness that we all have. And so because sweeteners taste sweet, taste begets taste, if you will. So the more you are exposed to a flavor, the more your preference is for that particular flavor. So the more you're exposed to sweet, the more you want sweet. So it becomes a big problem. So our current diet recommendations are a whole food, basically. I mean, we say it's a Mediterranean diet because that's probably as close to what it is as it is. You know, it's basically whole foods. It's little to no processed foods. It's whole fruit, never by itself, always paired with a fat or a protein. No juice, no applesauce, no dried fruit, because those are all just concentrated sweets. So just whole fruit with something else, milk and water. You need to have a healthy unsaturated fat with the meal. So things like olive oil, avocado, et cetera, nut butters are good because fat is important for brain development. Unsaturated fat is important for cholesterol. So saturated fat, not so good for cholesterol. Unsaturated fat, good for cholesterol. So an unsaturated fat source. And then we all know that it's very difficult to change the behavior of an older individual once they're locked into it. So, you know, we all the time tell people you can change the behavior of your 3-year-old. It is possible. You cannot change the behavior of your 21-year-old quite as easily. And so this young man was with me on his 21st birthday. He was not a happy camper when I told him that we had to take out some of his artificially sweetened stuff, actually all of it, because I don't negotiate. And I gave him this shirt, however, and in the Charlotte airport, he got offered to be bought a lot of alcoholic beverages. So I suspect that made up for me taking away the diet sodas and such. But nonetheless, he was not happy with me because it is much, much harder to change once behaviors are ingrained. So the one thing I love about my dietitian, Mike, is that he and I both think the same way. And that is, just because a kid doesn't like something doesn't mean you don't do it. So, you know, we say, you just, if they don't like vegetables, We don't care. You just keep serving them. You serve them and you serve them and you serve them and you serve them. And eventually the kid's going to break and we'll eat them, you know? And so, and he does it with his kids. I did it with my kids. We practice what we preach in our houses. And I think it's really important because we can say that to our patients that we understand that it's not as easy as one would like it to be, but it's much harder once they get older. So the sooner you do this, the better. Preferably start in infancy. This is Mike's handout on portion sizes, which I know is all over the internet, so you probably have already all seen. And we do this because I hate math and I'm not good at math. And I know I'm an endocrinologist. We like numbers, but I'm not good at math. Anyway, so I don't count calories. We do calories or portions by portion sizes. And we use the child's hand as our portion size guide. So the size of the child's fist is the size for the complex carbohydrates and the protein, and the size of the child's flat palm is the size of fruit, nuts, and seeds. And so we had one really awesome mom who actually took and made a circle the size of her son's palm, laminated it, sent it to school, and said, if you're going to serve him fruit or nuts, it's got to fit flat on this circle. No piled up, it's just got to fit flat there. And I thought that was a really nice way to make sure that the school followed the portion size guidelines. And actually, his weight went down because now all of a sudden they had a set portion guide that they could follow. So that was cool. The little banana picture is because people always underestimate or overestimate what a serving of a banana is. A serving of banana is the distance from your finger to your thumb. Okay. So for an adult, that's half of a banana. Okay. So for a kid, when people come in and they say, well, the kid has oatmeal and peanut butter and banana, and we say, how much banana? Oh, not much, just a half of a banana. Half a banana is an adult serving size. For a little kid, half a banana is probably like three times what they need in terms of a serving size of fruit. So remember, it's from this to this, and that's the serving size for a banana. So for most little kids, it's the nub of a banana if you're going to serve banana. And then I love this handout also. And again, I'm sure you've all seen it. This is something that Mike put together to build meals, where every meal should have a non-starchy vegetable, a protein, a complex carb, and a healthy unsaturated fat. Now, the thing that we've seen is people do tend to overdo this fat part of it, okay? Because they get all excited about adding something that has unsaturated fat, which is fine, except for sometimes you don't need it, okay? So if you're having an egg that's got fat in it, you don't need to add extra fat. If you're having chicken that you've cooked in olive oil, that's got fat because of the olive oil. You don't need to add extra. If you're having broiled chicken, broccoli, and brown rice, okay, fine. Then you add a couple slices of avocado or a little bit of olive oil to it to make sure there's a healthy unsaturated fat there. Weight is something I get asked about constantly. There is no magic weight. There's no magic weight for length. There's no magic BMI. I don't care what it is as long as your kid is healthy. And I would hope that most doctors agree with that and don't care what the BMI or the weight for length is as long as your kid is healthy. So I tell people all the time, please do not freak out over where your kid is on the BMI chart, because if they're eating a well-balanced, healthy diet, they feel good and solid and muscular, and they're exercising regular, I don't give a crap where they are on the BMI chart. These two young people both are at the 99th percentile on the BMI chart. I mean, you'd never guess it, right? They look great. So I don't care. You know, they look great. It doesn't, the number doesn't matter. It's all about how healthy you are. Okay. Exercise is also super important. I want my kids to exercise every day if possible. Exercise helps metabolism, muscle mass, bone health, and overall cardiovascular health. About a year ago in May, I started the PWS Challenge Club online to get kids to exercise more. It's not any kind of fundraising thing or anything like that. It's free. It's just a membership thing for kids to have other kids to watch and model exercise. And we've got 793 members now from around the world. And it's been amazing. So the picture down at the bottom there, you can see that at the end of each month, the kids that complete the assigned exercise get their name on this very cool light up board that goes in my office, and it lights up and it flashes and it's all different colors, and everyone gets to see their name for the month that they completed the exercise. And so it's really an awesome thing because, again, there's all kinds of pictures on there and videos on there of kids doing these various exercises. We have a physical therapist who helps to modify the exercises if the kid can't do it. And Maggie Sinise and Katie Moreau have been running it for me for the past, I think, 9 months or so, and have done just an amazing job at it. And it's really a very cool site. If your kid doesn't exercise, get on there, make them do it. Our goal is for every kid on there, all 793, to be able to do a 5K in some way, shape, or form by January 2022. Now we're going to talk about supplements. So supplements are hard because we don't know what we don't know. Okay. We know that there are certain supplements that you have to check levels of before you do. So those include things like vitamin D, iron, and folate. Some things aren't super reliable in the serum to check levels up before you supplement. So these are things like coenzyme Q10, carnitine, and B12. Now you can measure B12 in the serum. The problem is in Prader-Willi, B12 is high, even when you're not on a B12 supplement. So it's not a very reliable measure of B12. So we look at the red blood cell size on the blood count in order to determine if somebody might benefit from B12 supplement. But please, check with your physician before you start anything. Do not do a supplement just because you saw on Facebook that another mom did the supplement and her kid is doing fine. You know, I don't want you to do that. You need to check with your doctor before you do anything. In infancy, there are a couple supplements that we use a little bit more routinely. Coenzyme Q10 is one of them. You know that anecdotally, coenzyme Q10 may improve duration of suckling and daytime energy level in infants with Prader-Willi. Not in everyone, it's anecdotal evidence, but usually we'll try it if the kids are falling asleep while trying to eat, and that's what is keeping a tube in them as they can't stay awake to suckle. We will try coenzyme Q10. Carnitine is another one. Carnitine is in the mitochondria of the muscle, and it helps convert the energy you eat into energy in the muscle, and that helps with muscle tone. And so carnitine is supplemented in formula. It is not in breast milk, obviously. And so we will start carnitine very early on kids that are exclusively on breast milk. On formula, we typically start it a little later when they're about less than 22 ounces of formula per day. And then we'll supplement carnitine at that point in time. And then MCT oil is a big one that people ask about. It's medium chain triglycerides. It's broken down coconut oil, essentially. And often we use this in infancy because it's a nice way to add calories. It's easily metabolizable because it's broken down. It's a good source of dietary fat. And so if somebody is on breast milk only and the parents really don't want to add formula to supplement calories, we can add MCT to the breast milk to supplement calories and help with weight gain. In children and adults, some of the more common supplements that we use, vitamin D is pretty common. It is thought to be involved in prevention of various aspects of neurodegenerative or neuroimmune diseases. But vitamin D is a fat-soluble vitamin. You must measure levels before you give it. You must measure levels while you're on it, okay? You don't want to overdose it because that causes problems, okay? Low magnesium supplementing magnesium is also something common in children and adults. Low magnesium has been associated with things like anxiety and constipation. These are problems in Prader-Willi. But again, measure levels before you start. Measure levels while you're on. Iron, super important for oxygenation to produce energy in the brain. Low iron can be seen in kids with attention deficit disorder. It can be seen in people who have a lot of restless leg or move around a lot during sleep. So it's pretty common actually for kids with Prader-Willi to have some low iron. But again, iron, you gotta measure levels. You cannot just give it. You gotta measure and you gotta watch it while the kid is on it, because again, you don't want an overdose. And lastly is N-acetylcysteine, which is a supplement that modulates the glutaminergic system, which influences the reward reinforcement pathway. And that is, we use it a lot we try it a lot for people with skin picking and Prader-Willi. And so, and sometimes it works. It works in a fair proportion, I would say. And so I have heard, however, this is no longer going to be available as a supplement, that it's going to be prescription only, but I haven't seen that yet. I'm just mentioning it. Okay, medical issues in Prader-Willi syndrome. So endocrine issues, because this is what I do. 80 to 85% of children with Prader-Willi have growth hormone deficiency. We know that. We know it's not 100%. However, we do know that 100% can probably benefit from a little bit of growth hormone. So even if they don't have true growth hormone deficiency, giving growth hormone may likely still helps with metabolism and with body composition. So this is something that we just, you know, everybody, basically, we don't check levels before we start growth hormone. We don't look for growth hormone deficiency. We know that people are going to benefit from it. Only 8 to 50% of adults meet criteria for growth hormone deficiency. So once you're an adult, it's a lot harder to get growth hormone. And we'll talk about that in just a minute. Hypogonadism, or low sex hormones, are present in about 87% of individuals with Prader-Willi syndrome. Thyroid problems are present in about 15 to 25% of individuals with Prader-Willi syndrome. So that's something that has to be monitored every year, all through childhood and adulthood. Central adrenal insufficiency, the data is kind of all over the map. There's been some studies that suggest 0% and some studies that suggest 60% have central adrenal insufficiency. The test is pretty awful. You get false positives and false negatives. So it's not something that's generally done as standard of care to do the stimulation test to look for central adrenal insufficiency. There are certain circumstances that we do it in, and I'll talk about those in just a minute too. Low blood sugar, fairly common in young infants and in adults. So it's something we have to watch for. Also present in those who have adrenal insufficiency. And then type 2 diabetes is present in about 20 to 25% of adults. So IGF-1 is a surrogate marker for growth hormone. It's the protein that's made when growth hormone binds to its receptors. And the way that endocrinologists monitor growth hormone dose is using this IGF-1 level, okay, as the surrogate marker for what the growth hormone dose is. The problem is, as many of you have experienced by now, and those of you who have younger children will experience, when kids with Prader-Willi hit nutritional phase 2A, their IGF-1 level goes up without a change in their growth hormone dose, okay? And decreasing the growth hormone dose to bring that IGF-1 level back down into the normal range may actually decrease some of the positive effects of the growth hormone, which we don't want. So the Dutch group did a very beautiful study on this, led by Anita Hoken. And what she showed is that while total IGF-1 becomes elevated starting at around 2 years of age, free IGF-1, which is your biologically metabolically active IGF-1, which is actually what's from the growth hormone, is typically normal for age. So what is recommended to, you can't measure, of course, a free IGF-1, you have to calculate it. So it's a molar ratio between IGF-1 and its binding protein, IGF-BP3. The problem is, in a lot of countries like Canada and South America, you can't get an IGF-BP3. So you can't, calculate that molar ratio. That makes it a little bit more difficult. But I just counsel people that elevated IGF-1 level that happens at around 2 years of age doesn't mean that the growth hormone dose should necessarily come down. Now, if the child has signs of overgrowth, so if, they're growing extremely rapidly, if their bone age is advancing rapidly, anything like that, then yes, you bring it down, the growth hormone dose. But ideally, that usually doesn't happen, and because the free IGF-1 is normal typically, okay? And we know that IGF-1 levels in adults correlate with quality of life, appetite, and things like that. And so research is being done right now to see if IGF-1 levels in kids, particularly young kids, will ultimately correlate over time with things like cognitive score, body composition, or metabolism. As I mentioned, adult growth hormone is very difficult to get once growth has been completed, but it's known from Charlotte Hoiby's group as well as others that adult growth hormone treatment improves mental speed and flexibility as well as motor performance. It improves self-control, it improves behavior, it improves vitality, it improves quality of life. And so the interesting thing that Charlotte showed in her studies was that regardless of whether or not someone passed or failed growth hormone stimulation testing, they had a positive effect from growth hormone therapy. And so, I personally feel that there should be a push to get growth hormone approved for people with Prader-Willi of all ages, because I definitely think people who are adults still benefit from growth hormone therapy. Monitoring for endocrine stuff, thyroid, like I said, every year after age 3. And we usually now recommend TSH, T4, and T3 for monitoring. T3, because a lot of adults actually have low levels of T3, which is your active thyroid hormone. So we monitor that as well now. Earlier in life, so from infancy until about age 3, we check twice a year at least, as long as there's no symptoms. If there's symptoms, constipation, excessive weight gain that's unexplained, things like that, you check more frequently. But hypothyroidism most commonly presents in children around 2 years of age, which is, of course, right when that weight gain without a change in calories starts, nutritional phase 2A. So it's sometimes hard to distinguish. You want to make sure that you always check thyroid, even if you think, oh, well, this might just be nutritional phase 2A. You still need to check thyroid because you can get weight gain with hypothyroidism too. Adrenal insufficiency, as I mentioned, the numbers are all over the map. The recommendation is to check either using a baseline 8 a.m. cortisol or to do a stimulation test if the child has a lot of frequent and severe illnesses. So they end up in the hospital with dehydration every time they get a cold or something like that. And then usually we will check prior to surgery, if at all possible, to try to get a level of cortisol to make sure the child's going to be okay with anesthesia, which is a big stress on the body. Gonads are something that we monitor during puberty and during infancy. So in the baby girls, we can't do much. In the baby boys, we can treat them with testosterone or HCG to improve the size of the penis and the scrotal sac. And sometimes that will help the undescended testes come down into the scrotal sac. Not always, but sometimes it will. And so in both males and females, if we need to treat, we treat in puberty if we don't treat in infancy. And blood sugars, we recommend you check if you're concerned at all, or if your doctor's concerned at all. And then after age 10, it's recommended that you check a hemoglobin A1C, which is a measure of blood sugars over a 3-month period of time, annually or more often if there's concerns like more peeing a lot or drinking a lot. Sex hormones, it's interesting. More and more individuals are going through puberty spontaneously now. Not sure why, couldn't tell you, but it's really kind of cool. I prefer to not have to do anything if I don't have to. And there are hormone levels that you can check to see about someone's potential for fertility. And we're also seeing more individuals with Prader-Willi who are having these hormone levels that are consistent with the fact that they may potentially be fertile. Now we don't know if this is going to be, you know, if this is going to hold out. Does that mean, you know, sperm and eggs are normal? I don't know. Okay. But there is these changes in the way that these hormone levels are presenting, where it used to be that no males presented with fertility. In today's world, about 50% of our adolescent and young adult males have hormone levels that are consistent with possible fertility. So that being said, that means you got to talk about it. Because individuals with Prader-Willi, no matter what their sex hormone levels are, have a normal sex drive, okay? They have a normal sexual affiliation, just like anyone else. So they can be heterosexual, homosexual, asexual. We have some individuals who are transgender. So you gotta have the discussion, because if the potential for fertility is there, you have to make them aware of what they need to do to protect the woman or themselves from pregnancy in the future. Sleep issues. Super common, as you know. You've heard a lot about sleep issues during this conference. The major concern with starting growth hormone in children is worsening of obstructive sleep apnea due to tonsils and adenoids growing from growth hormone. What I've learned since the last conference is that babies don't have tonsils and adenoids. So adenoids come at about 7 to 9 months of age, tonsils at about 15 to 16 months of age. So if you're starting a baby under the age of 6 months on growth hormone therapy, there's really no risk of tonsil and adenoid growth at that point in time. It's only after the age of 7 months that there is a risk and that you need to consider doing a sleep study prior to starting growth hormone. Now, I'm not saying don't do a sleep study, because some individuals, some babies can have central sleep apnea, which is responsive to low flow oxygen. But if you're looking for obstructive sleep apnea, almost any baby with Prader-Willi is going to have that, because they've got low tone, and that includes in the respiratory muscles and in the airway. So the airway can collapse upon itself pretty easily. And growth hormone is going to actually help that, not make it worse. So if you're doing a sleep study to look for obstruction, probably not the right reason if they're under 6 months, knowing that growth hormone will help in the obstructive sleep apnea. But it could identify central sleep apnea, which again can be treated with oxygen. As you know, excessive daytime sleepiness in infancy and young childhood is pretty typical. And at age 2 to 3, those of you who have 2 to 3 to 4 year olds know that this fun stage of getting up at 2 to 5 a.m. becomes pretty common. We don't know why that is. We're actually currently about to start investigating that to try to figure that out, because they're not food seeking. They're not hungry. They're just up. They'll be in their bed playing, they'll read a book, whatever, but it leads to some very grumpy children or kids that fall asleep in the car on the way to school and the way home from school, you know. So we'd like to try to figure out why this is happening, because it is happening, and I would say a fair majority of individuals this age with Prader-Willi. And then the other thing is they can have abnormal sleep as well. So sleep onset REM, abnormal sleep cycles, nocturnal arousals. This is one of the reasons that the pitolisant study is being done, that phase 2 study that you may have heard about earlier in the pharmaceutical conversation. So sleep studies, when do you need them? I have people ask me this all the time. Do you need it every 6 months? Do you need it every year? No. sleep studies are terrible for everybody involved, in my personal opinion, because they have all that stuff you see in the picture all over them. You have to sleep on your back most of the time. Not everybody likes to do that. It's kind of miserable. So if your kid has increased daytime sleepiness, snoring, pauses in breathing during sleep, frequent nighttime awakening, or new onset behavioral problems, you bought yourself a sleep study, okay? And you have to get it done. So tired kids are grumpy kids, okay? So when somebody calls me and says, my kid's acting out in daycare and they're biting and they're kicking and whatever, and oh, this Prader-Willi, nah, it's tired. Your kid needs a sleep study, okay? So before you go talk to Dr. Bedard about behavioral therapy, your kid's getting a sleep study, okay? Because 9 times out of 10, kids who are having behavioral problems are tired and they need something done to fix their sleep. So narcolepsy and cataplexy is the other thing that it was discussed again in the pitolisant discussion this morning. And narcolepsy and cataplexy are fairly common in Prader-Willi. And the reason for this is that we know that individuals with Prader-Willi don't have typical orexin receptors. And orexin is a neurotransmitter that mediates behavior under situations of high motivation. Okay, so what's high motivation in Prader-Willi syndrome? Food is pretty high motivation in Prader-Willi syndrome. So it's a pretty powerful emotional stimulus. And so what you'll see is because of this abnormality in orexin receptors in the hypothalamus of people with Prader-Willi, there is very commonly narcolepsy and or cataplexy that can occur in the context of food. So you can see kids, you know, eyes rolling back, falling asleep when the plate of food is in front of them and they start to eat. You can even see them go face first in the plate of food. With the cataplexy, they lose muscle control. This also, by the way, I think this is fascinating, happens in Doberman pinschers and Labrador retrievers when they're presented with food. Kind of fun. But it also in kids with Prader-Willi can happen during anything that's a high motivational experience. So playing, laughing, things like that will often cause narcolepsy and cataplexy. So high emotional stimulus, you get narcolepsy, cataplexy. Treatment is a little bit more complex. Treatment includes SSRIs, tricyclic antidepressants, stimulants, modafinil or armodafinil, which are provigil or nuvigil, sodium oxybate, which is GHB, or pitolisant. And so pitolisant, like I said, is still being investigated in Prader-Willi syndrome. These other things, some work for some work for others. It's kind of, there's no set answer, unfortunately, for this problem, which is fairly common. I know y'all just heard Dr. Scheinman give her GI talk, so I'm not going to belabor this. This is the short Dr. Miller version. You heard the long Dr. Scheinman version. So my big take here is the bezoars, which is the undigested vegetable matter that we often see, specifically in kids who are on really low carb diet. So kids who don't have a lot of complex carbs in their diet and are eating vegetables as their primary source of starch, will often get a clump of this undigested vegetable cellulose in their stomach. And this can actually block gastric emptying. And that's a big problem. So Anne might kill me for saying this, but I'm going to say it anyway, that if you ever have your kid in the hospital and they find a bezoar, before you let them take your kid to the OR, call her or call me, because the treatment actually can be a can of Coke. Coke will dissolve anything. So it can save a kid from undergoing laparoscopy sometimes, not always, because it's not always vegetable matter, but if it is, that may be an answer. So that's that. The other thing I wanted to bring up in this GI talk is the concept of the Ozempic, which is the new GLP-1, well, it's not that new, but it was just, there was just a big article about it and how people lost 15% of their body weight on it. And I've gotten asked a lot of questions about this. The problem with those type of drugs is people with Prader-Willi have delayed gastric emptying, especially in the face of constipation. And so if you take that drug and then you get into a lot of food and you've already got delayed gastric emptying, now you've got worse delayed gastric emptying because you're on the drug, you actually have a higher risk of gastric necrosis. All right, I'm going to fly through clinical trials because I am almost out of time and I talked too much and I'm sorry. And so you probably have heard all this anyway, so I'm just going to run through it real quick. So intranasal oxytocin, there are some studies being done in Europe currently. There have been several studies already done, both in infants and children and adults, to try to fix in infants suckling and maternal infant bonding, in children and adults hyperphagia, behavior, anxiety. The outcomes are exceedingly mixed. Some show positive, some show negative, some show nothing. So these longer term studies are currently being done in the EU. The levocarbetocin study, you may have heard about earlier this morning in the pharmaceutical talk. It was a phase 3 study that I'm going to show you the data from 119 patients. The data collection for these data analysis was stopped at March 1st, 2020, because both this and the DCCR trial were interrupted by COVID, which of course skews results on subjective questionnaires, which were the primary outcome measure for both of these trials. So for this trial, hyperphagia questionnaire score was the primary outcome measure, and then the Children's Yale Brown Obsessive Compulsive score was also a secondary outcome measure, as well as what was called the PADQ, the PWS Anxiety and Distress Behaviors Questionnaire, as well as a clinician global impression of change done by the physicians, and a caregiver global impression of change done by the caregivers. This was double-blind, randomized, placebo-controlled for 8 weeks, and then everybody was offered the opportunity to go into an open-label extension for safety. What you can see here is there were two doses tried, 9.6 milligrams and 3.2 milligrams, and the 3.2 milligram dose was superior to the 9.6 milligram dose in terms of reduction of hyperphagia questionnaire score. And this table shows that indeed the 3.2 milligram dose, which unfortunately was not the primary outcome measure, the primary outcome measure was the 9.6 milligram dose, because that's what had been tried previously in the Ferring pharmaceutical trials of this drug. But the 3.2 milligram dose proved to be superior in terms of reduction in hyperphagia score, as I mentioned, reduction in the anxiety and distress behavior questionnaire, improvement in clinical global impression of change, and caregiver impression of change. And this data shows that out to week 64, those who have completed that time frame, the reduction in hyperphagia questionnaire continued, as well as did the reduction in the anxiety and distress questionnaire scores. The DCCR trial, again, interrupted by COVID. So I'll show you some of the top line data, as well as the data cut at March 1st, just like with Levo, which is when the quarantine started in the United States. This was a 13-week double-blind placebo-controlled trial where individuals, 127 individuals, were randomized in a 2-to-1 fashion to receive DCCR versus placebo. 120 completed that, 115 went on to participate in the open label safety extension, and just over 100 are still participating at about 3 years out at this point. So the primary endpoint again was a subjective questionnaire, was the hyperphagia questionnaire again. Secondary endpoints were body composition by DEXA, as well as that clinical global impression of change and caregiver global impression of change. What you can see on this slide is on the left is the data cut at March 1st, so pre-COVID. So this was data cut at March 1st when the quarantine started. And you can see that DCCR is superior statistically and clinically to placebo in terms of reduction of hyperphagia questionnaire score. It also held in terms of clinical global impression of improvement, change in fat mass on DEXA, although that maintained with or without the COVID cut because it was a hard, fast data point and like a scientific data point versus a questionnaire or subjective data point, which were much more altered by the whole quarantine situation. So anyway, so body fat by DEXA was significant reductions, improvement in caregiver impression of change and clinician impression of change were statistically significant. And this is the DEXA data. What you can see is here is marked as the fat mass reduction versus placebo, where there was actually an increase, a slight increase in fat mass. And what was really interesting is prior to starting the study, most people had a body composition that was about 50-50 and lean to fat mass. And at the end of the 13-week trial, what you saw is that the people on placebo stayed there. The people on DCCR actually had a marked improvement in that ratio with more lean muscle mass and less fat mass. So that was kind of cool to see. And this was my favorite part of the whole study because I didn't expect this to happen. So it was kind of cool when it did, that DCCR also improved things like aggressive behaviors, anxiety, rigidity, and irritability, compulsivity, disordered thinking, communication, and social relationships. So that was really fun to see and very exciting. So as you know, from the talks this morning, there are more studies coming, a bunch of studies listed there. Most of those people talked to you this morning. Not all of them. And then the last is the gut microbiome, which you know, Ann Scheinman and Dan Driscoll and myself have said for many, many, many years that the gut microbiome has to be involved in some of these nutritional phase changes that we see in Prader-Willi. And indeed now, as people are starting to look at the gut microbiome, they're seeing how different it is in people with Prader-Willi compared to their families, and trying to do research on pre and probiotics in order to try to alter that, to maybe ameliorate some of the symptoms of Prader-Willi, things like anxiety, constipation, things like that. And this little picture at the bottom where those little orange dots are circled, that is multiple samples from an individual with Prader-Willi. And you can see the other dots that are way far away from that are his sister, his mom, and his dad. So very, very different from the rest of his family in terms of his gut microbiome composition. And so that's it. I do have a video to show you though, so you cannot get off because you have to see it because it's awesome. This is Chaz. Chaz is on the DCCR trial. He's lost over 100 pounds. He's doing great. Cameras off, locks off. I promised I'd show his picture because he's awesome. And I am happy to answer any questions you have, but I'm going to show my video first. So hold on. I have to get rid of this and do another one because I talk too much. Screen sharing stopped. Okay. I don't care about that. Good.
Today, it all begins. I'm seeing my life for the very first time through a different lens. Yesterday, didn't understand. Driving 35 with a rocket inside, didn't know what I had. While I've been waiting to live, my life's been waiting on me. I'm gonna run. No, I'm gonna fly. I'm gonna know what it means to live. Am I just being alive? The world's gonna hear. Cause I'm gonna shine. And I will be dancing when circumstances drown the
when it rains, it pours, but you didn't even notice. It ain't raining anymore. It's hard to breathe when all you know is the struggle of staying above the rising water line. Well, the sky is finally open. The rain and wind stop blowing, but you're stuck out in the same old storm again. You hold tight to your umbrella, but darling, I'm just trying to tell you that there's always been a rainbow hanging over your head. If you could see what I see, you'd be blinded by the color, yellow, red, orange, and green, and at least a million others. To tie up the bow, take off your coat, and take a look around. 'Cause the sky is finally open, the rain and wind stop blowing, but you're stuck out in the same old storm again. You hold tight to your umbrella. Well, darling, I'm just trying to tell you that there's always been a rainbow hanging over your head. Oh, tie up the bow, take off your coat, take a look around. Everything is all right now, 'cause the sky is finally opened. The rain and wind stop blowing, but you're stuck out in the same old storm again. Let go of your umbrella, 'cause darling, I'm just trying to tell you that there's always been a rainbow hanging over your head. Yeah, there's always been a rainbow hanging over your head. It'll all be
all right, that's it. I'm done now.
Awesome. Thank you, Dr. Miller. That was amazing. That was a great presentation. And I think you win the fastest speaking award.
Always.
So that's
not a good wonderful thing.
We actually have we have about 7 minutes. Are you okay taking a few questions? Okay. One of the questions was about your slides. Would you be willing to share your slides?
I will take pictures out, patient pictures out, but yes, I will be happy to share them, but I'm going to remove pictures.
Okay, perfect. Here's just a comment. Thanks for all you do. How can our kiddos participate in your future gut biome studies?
Ooh, good question. They are on, the study is going to be on the Running for Research site that Kelly Giu runs. And that's the first gut microbiome study that we're doing. So you can go onto that site and look for information on it. It hasn't started yet.
Okay, perfect. What do you recommend for our kids who do not drink water?
Keep giving it. I mean, that's all you can do. You just, you know, I mean, what Mike and I tell people is you just keep introducing it. You know, you make it part of your routine. You take a sip before you take your, you know, you eat your breakfast. You take a sip before you brush your teeth. You take a sip after you brush your teeth until it just becomes part of their routine. It's just behavioral modification.
Right. Can you give a couple of examples of carb-free snacks?
No. I'm sure Mike could, but he's not on here. I mean, he's probably not listening, but he has a list. And we don't necessarily recommend carb, well, I mean, I guess I could. We don't recommend necessarily carb-free snacks, that just that you do a carb paired with a fat or a protein. So you could do like Triscuits and cheese. Triscuits are a great carb because they're just whole wheat, oil, and salt. And so a couple Triscuits and some cheese is a great snack. Or you could do cheese by itself, or a few nuts by itself, or, you know, I guess a meat stick, although that's a saturated fat, so I wouldn't probably do that, but, you know, things like that. But we have a whole snack list that Mike put together that's got things like nuts and seeds and stuff, but also some carb-containing snacks, but you just have to make sure that you pair it with a fat and a protein. You want the carbs to be a complex carb and also paired with something.
Perfect. Thank you. We had a few sharing sessions earlier this afternoon, and the Birth to Three group, they want to know, people wanted to know what causes the skin picking.
We don't know what causes the skin picking. It's definitely behavioral. If you heard Casey Bedard talk yesterday, she talked about how it is fixable, you know, it is modifiable behavior. And we certainly have seen that for sure. But we're not sure what causes it. But it typically starts in nutritional phase 2B and often will worsen as, you know, hyperphagia is starting to get a little bit worse. But not in everyone by any means. So we don't really know the answer, unfortunately.
It's a big question for everybody, but thank you. What age do you recommend starting testosterone treatment? Our son is 12 years old.
So everybody is different. I don't usually start it until older than that, usually around 13, or if puberty is continuing to progress based on measuring levels of gonadotropins, then I will let the child be and see what they'll do on their own before starting testosterone.
Perfect. I just want to read this. Thank you. It says, no one has done more to help families with PWS than Dr. Miller. We thank you for the hope you infused into our families. Thanks for all your sacrifices and thank your family.
Oh, that's very sweet and not true, but thank you.
Well, it's true. We appreciate you. If carbetocin is approved, would it be for the 3.2 dose, or are they trying to approve the lower dose with the FDA?
I do not know the answer to that. I assume the 3.2, but I don't know. Unfortunately, I did ask Levo if they would potentially be on to answer questions about carbetocin, since I knew I'd be presenting carbetocin and DCCR stuff. And Dr. Bhatnagar from Soleno is on if there's specific DCCR questions that he can answer. Unfortunately, I don't have anyone from Levo on to answer the question, but they did say that if people had specific carbetocin questions, they could go to their website and there's a place where you can email the company to ask those questions.
There's an advocacy question. How can parents help advocate for treatments like DCCR?
You know, Dr. Bhatnagar, turn your camera and your microphone on. I would like your opinion on this one.
Thank you. I think a lot is being done already. I mean, what PWSA, Paige and her team and FPWR are doing is tremendous. There's a lot of work already going on from the community side. And we talked a little bit about that in the pharma panel session where we talked about the town halls, et cetera. So a lot is being done. And I think generally speaking, just being aware of what's going on, being educated about what's going on, adding your voice to anything that comes your way. If there are surveys, answer the surveys. If there's calls to action from your advocacy organizations, answer that. Participate in meetings, town halls, et cetera. I would say that's the best you can do.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. This question, Dr. Miller, is the one that comes up all the time. Are you taking new patients now? My baby was born in October, but we are told you're not taking new patients. We would love to have her under your care.
Yeah, unfortunately right now, because my clinic is so full, you know, there's really no one to take over the care of adult patients with Prader-Willi right now. So I'm seeing my oldest patient is 65. So that tends to fill a clinic when you're doing babies through adulthood. And I only do clinic 2 days a week. So unfortunately, my clinics are pretty jam-packed because most of my time is spent doing research on these studies, which I think is very important to do. And so unfortunately, that is correct. I am not taking new patients right now.
Okay, thank you. Here's a question just about constipation. Would Metamucil fiber supplement be good for kids who have constipation?
That is an Ann Scheiman question, not a Jen Miller question. I do not know the answer.
Ask Ann Scheiman. Okay.
That's correct. That's my answer.
What do you think about the red, yellow, green diet? Is it out of date?
Yes. As I said, it is out of date. It is something that I think is, I mean, for acute weight loss, it works, right? You know, because it's really calorie restricted, and it works. But for sustainability, I think it's not sustainable long-term. I think we've seen that over the years. And we feel that a diet that is more Mediterranean-like is much more sustainable. And I know that it's not just Mike Tan, my dietitian, who's recommending that. I know Melanie Silverman, who spoke yesterday, I think, is also recommending that. Kate Fox, who's a dietitian in Australia, is recommending it. So I think it's the sort of Mediterranean-ish diet is gaining more favor amongst the community because it's much more sustainable. And it's a way that every person in this world should eat. And so that makes it so that, you know, families can all eat the same thing, which is really nice. You know, on red, yellow, green, sometimes the kid with Prader-Willi is eating different than the rest of the family. And that's really hard and not fair. And so I like this diet because it enables one meal to be cooked and everybody eats the same. Yeah. And it's healthy for us all.
Great point. Yes. So more about skin picking, what is NAC and how does it work? And is there a specific dosage we should look at?
So Dr. Singh in his talk did recommend a specific dosage, and I cannot remember exactly what that is. So you might have to ask him. Do you remember what it was, Paige?
I just remember that he said start small and then go. He did not give the upper limit though, because he did not want to give that number out. So I would check with your physician.
I agree with that. So it is a supplement. It works on the glutamate system in the brain, which is your reward reinforcement system. And so the idea is that it blocks that reward that one would get from that behavior of skin picking. So whatever that reward is that don't understand, but there is a reward there clearly for people who do it, you know, that the NAC would block that reward response. So it's used in things like compulsive gambling, alcoholism, things like that, because it can block that reward response mechanism. You know, again, I definitely would say, I agree, start low and then talk to your physician about upper limits of dosing. The one thing I would say to know about NAC that's really, really important that a lot of people don't know is that calcium actually makes it less active. So don't do it with milk. Okay, because if you take it with anything that contains calcium, so whether that's almond milk or whatever, I mean, anything that's got calcium supplementation in it, it's going to make it less effective. So I just saw an adult from a group home the other day, and he was taking the NAC with his morning milk. And so, I was like, well, no wonder it doesn't work. Yeah.
Yeah, good point. One last question about skin picking is there any correlation between modafinil and skin picking?
Not that I'm aware of, no.
Okay. How often can a child do HCG treatments to descend testes?
So typically the recommendation is no more than two courses. Usually the recommendation is one course only, done in infancy sometime between the ages of 3 and 9 months.
Okay. Perfect. What age would you recommend starting their child on B12 supplements if needed?
If needed, whenever they're needed. So whenever that would be. So most kids get, the babies get plenty of B12 in their diet. It's in formula, you know, it's in foods, some foods, you know, but toddlers often get deficient because they're not getting a lot of B12 in their diet. So that's when we start measuring.
There's a question, I don't know that you will know the answer to this, but is CRISPR in the future applicable to our population?
That is a Dan Driscoll question, not a Jen Miller question. I would assume the answer is yes, but I do not want to assume because I am so not a geneticist. I'm not smart enough to be a geneticist. So you need to ask a geneticist that question.
Okay, and one quick question, since we do have a niche on here, have either Levo or Soleno continued to collect data, even though enrollment shut down for COVID?
I can speak to our program. So we have an ongoing study. It's called C602. It's the extension study to 6601. So everyone who completed 601 had the opportunity to start open label treatment on DCCR. And of the 120 completers, I believe 115 joined 602, and about 100 are still on the study. So we are actively treating them. We're collecting data. There was a big hiatus of people going to the sites because of COVID, but we have just recently had people come back and do new DEXA scans, et cetera. So we're excited to see that data, and we're certainly continuing to collect it.
And since you're here, are you taking any new patients for the clinical trial?
We don't have any new clinical trials going on right now, but we will certainly keep you posted if we do.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
We are just about out of time. One more question. How often do kids, Dr. Miller, need to up their growth hormone dosage?
It's very individual. Unfortunately, there's no right answer to that question. It's super individual. I would say that typically between the ages of around 2 and 6 years of age, the growth hormone dose doesn't change very much for most kids because kids naturally just don't make a lot of growth hormone on their own during that time, like typically developing kids. So kids with Prader-Willi who are supplemented with it don't typically need a lot of extra growth hormone during that time above and beyond what they're already on. So, but it's very individual. Some kids do, some kids don't. And again, when you change doses is also very individual based on the child. And it's based on a number of factors, not just the blood levels, but also of course, growth, weight, muscle mass, all kinds of stuff.
Great. Do you have any thoughts on the COVID shot for our kids?
I'm recommending it for everyone. I think it's, you know, potentially very beneficial, probably better than getting COVID, I would think. So it's my personal opinion.
And this question came up in an earlier session, but do you recommend the neuropharmacologic testing to direct psychiatric meds?
So, you know, we did recommend it for a while, but what we found was that when kids were getting it done, sometimes they were switching from, like, based on the results, they would be, you know, being successful on a certain med, they would get the results of that, and it would say that that med wasn't recommended, so then they would switch to one of the ones that was, and then they would have a disastrous response. So I think that I am so not a psychiatrist either, so I would defer to the psychiatrist on that question, but my personal feeling, having watched it for several years, is that it's not something that, as long as a kid is stable and doing well on their psych meds, that I typically would recommend that parents get done, because I did see a lot of people switch off of meds based on the results of that testing, and they were doing just fine on the med they were on.
And one quick question, have you seen any issues in drinking coffee in kids or adults? We know that sometimes it's recommended to help them stay awake during the day, but what are your thoughts?
Love coffee. Most of my successful adults who, graduated high school with a regular diploma did coffee. That was their stimulant of choice because other stimulants didn't exist. You know, the problem with coffee is most people put stuff in it, right? So either sweetener or creamer or flavored creamer or whatever. That's the problem with coffee. So if you can do it without any crap in there, perfect. But if you can't, if you've got to put sweetener in there, then I don't recommend it.
Right. What about a DEXA scan? How often should my child get a DEXA scan?
So in adulthood, like after adolescence, after age 16, it's generally recommended once every 2 years.
What about before then?
Before then, it's not typically recommended.
Okay, great. Well, we are out of time. Thank you so much, Dr. Miller. Seleno, thank you for being here as well. And we will close this session with Dr. Miller, and actually we won't close the session. We'll stay on for our closing comments. And
superhero bingo.
Yes. What are we doing tonight, Dr. Miller?
Superhero bingo.
Superhero bingo. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. Anyway. All right. Thank you so much. Thank you, Anish, as well.
Thank you.
And for everybody else that is still staying on here, we will do just a quick wrap up of our convention. It has been quite a week. As it comes to a close, I just want to reflect on the amazing amount of information and education that we have shared, that has been shared with all of us this week. We've had so many great sessions and topics and presenters. we've been able to bring to this conference. And I just am so amazed that we had over 1,500 registrants. I know many people will be listening to these sessions afterwards. The ones that are recorded, we will have again out on our website as soon as we can get them out there. We want to really, though, thank our Lighthouse sponsors. So Soleno Therapeutics, Levo Therapeutics, as well as all of our other wonderful sponsors. But it is because of them that we were able to bring this to you free. And we are so excited. We had over 800 families. So we know we reached so many more families than we've been able to reach in the past. So we're so excited about that. And we've just had some more, you know, just great sessions, the breakout sharing sessions by age group. I was in one of them, but I got a lot of feedback on how well those went. So just a phenomenal week, you know, professional providers, the med sci, 2 days in med sci and 2 days of our family convention, I think have been amazing. And I just really want to thank our families, most of all. I mean, everything we do here at PWSA on a daily basis is for our families. So thank you to all the families for attending. We're not quite finished before we go. For those of you who bought raffle tickets, which again, those raffle tickets, the money from that goes to support families for in-person, future in-person conventions. So Stacy Ward is going to come on and she is going to spin the wheel and let us know who won the raffle. Stacy?
All right. Let's share my screen so that you
and while she's doing that, Stacy is our director of family support. So she and her team are the ones who are answering all of your questions on a daily basis, 24/7, 365. So just a shout out to Stacy and her team for all that they do for our families. All right. Stacy's got this the wheel up.
All right, let's see. The winner is Susan Farwell. Susan, I'm going to send you an email. Congratulations.
Yay, Susan, congratulations. That's great. Thank you for participating in that. And now before we close today, as Dr. Miller mentioned, in about 35, 40 minutes, we're going to be heading over to our superhero bingo night. So for those of you that signed up for that, I'm looking forward to seeing everybody. I think that's gonna be a fun filled night. We've got prizes, we have silent auction, we have some special superhero guests stopping by. So thanks to all of our families, friends, group homes that are going to be joining us. I think it will be a fun event that starts at 6 o'clock. So we will see you over there. And again, I just really want to thank everybody, our sponsors, the chairs of our conferences, the co-chairs, all the moderators who helped out throughout this convention, the event technical staff. We could have not done this without you. Just everybody, staff, board of directors, everybody that worked so hard on this to make this possible. We appreciate it. And we look forward to seeing everybody, hopefully in person, at our next conference. So thank you for joining us. And hopefully we'll see many of you soon. Have a good night. Thanks.